Yeah, I mean, Kota is an amazing place, man. Like, everyone should visit Kota. At that very moment, I realized, like, shit, this has never happened with me in India. Neither have I followed.
Experience.
People, I've seen people carry trash like for 10 kilometers on end till they are able to dispose it over there.
Right.
अपने यहाँ तो यार फेंक देते हैं सड़क पे ऐसे होता है. Get rich quick scheme. 2 minutes do this course, you will be done. 5 minutes take this tutorials and you will be done. It takes the kind of work that Sharad is showing you in the sense of preparation that he did, the rejections that he's faced, the maths he's learned.
Like a masala Bollywood flick. Okay, all this high, there's, high intellectual
stuff. There is no
stuff.
Rom-com in my life right now. So no rom-com.
Okay. Hello everybody and a warm welcome to this new series that we are launching, the Edist Pro Talks. As per the request of all of our viewers, we are launching the series where we invite somebody from the industry, a software developer, a project manager, a product manager, anybody who's in the software industry to tell about their experiences on how they got into a job, what they are working on these days, what their advice for freshers is and so on. So yeah, welcome to this new series. If you want to ask us or you want to participate in this series, reach out to us on our Instagram handle, which is @edistme. You can just reach out to that one and you will start getting notifications about upcoming guests. And you can also reach out to us with your questions and, you know, whatever queries you have. Today's session as well, we are featuring some questions and queries that we have received from our Instagram channel itself. So please do reach out to us on that one for every new guest that you want. And as usual, if you have some more questions, let us know in the comments below. We'll make sure that we pass it on to our guests and get the responses as well. So before I start the session, I will bring in my co-host for the day. And you know him, I know him, we all know him for a long time. Hi Abhinandan, how are you?
That was a very, very nice introduction, Anik. You know him, I know him. I'm really, really happy to be on this one. Yeah. Super, super excited for today's Edist Pro Talks.
Right.
First in our series, hopefully a long, long series, just like our GAN series. But yeah, really happy to be here, Anik.
So for those of you watching the first time, my name is Anik. I am the co-founder of Edist. Abhinandan is also co-founder at Edist. He handles all tech-related things. And you, for those of you who have seen us before, you might be wondering why we are not talking in Hindi. Yaar, har session GAN session nahi hota hai. Isme bhi Hindi mein baat hogi. Or I'll just translate. We'll talk in Hindi in this one as well, now and then. But we just felt that the kind of information we'll discuss here will be very useful to everybody involved. So hence, we're also talking in English. So yeah, without further delay, let's get our first guest for the Edist Pro Talks. And please give a warm welcome to Mr. Sharad Gupta. Hi, Sharad. How are you doing?
Hi, Anik. Thanks a lot for the invitation. I'm good. How about you?
I'm doing good. So before, you know, I just hand it over to Sharad. Guys, Sharad is a really good, really dear friend of ours. We know him. It's been 10 years at least now. It's, I think, the 10th year since you know him. He's a batchmate from college and, you know, he's a really fun guy. So I hope we get to see this fun side as well on this thing. But as you might have already seen from the thumbnail, he works at Bloomberg right now, but he's much more than that. So Sharad, where are you joining us from today?
I'm currently in New York. So yeah, I'm joining from New York.
Brilliant.
It's almost 12 at night.
Yeah, so at the time of recording, it's late night for him, it's early morning for us. It's both. Actually, it's neither late night nor early morning in that sense.
But yeah, guys, if you can see like the edge of his screen, okay, Sharad's screen is the New York skyline, by the way. I don't know if you can see that, but
that's the backdrop of every 90s Bollywood movie. The hero goes off to New York or something like that, you know. Or at least a song will be shot somewhere there. New York or Switzerland. That's great.
Fun fact, guys. I think, Sharad, you can see the Statue of Liberty from your window, right? Like,
yeah.
Is it this window? Probably another one.
It's from the living room. I can see the Statue of Liberty.
Yeah, guys. Our boy from Indore has finally made it.
Not from Indore.
Gwalior.
Don't
respect the FP. Okay?
sorry.
Yeah.
No, but Sharad, I mean, for the people who are new here, just give us a quick intro about yourself. Like, obviously, you were batchmates with us at IIIT Hyderabad, but then after that, like, what all you've done, you know, what are you doing right now? Just a quick intro about yourself.
Okay, sure. So I can briefly describe like what I've been up to after I graduated from undergrad with these two wonderful people. So I joined, like after my graduation, I joined as a software developer in a Japanese company called Works Application in Singapore. So I worked there for almost 2 years, pretty much like working on a new application, like learned a lot since it was a very like in an early phase. So yeah, I was in the like most, like I was contributing a lot when I joined. So yeah, like for 2 years, I was there as a software developer, backend engineer, whatever you want to say. And then I think after 2 years, I was missing, I thought that I was missing something, which led me to apply for my master's in data science. So I went to States, United States, to do my master's in data science from Stony Brook University. So there I did my master's. Yeah, I learned a lot there as well, made some pretty good friends. And then after that, I joined Bloomberg as a software engineer again. But this time it was different little, because something which drove me from Singapore to US was like that missing link, or maybe something which was not interesting. I mean, which I was not finding that interesting at that point of time. But yeah, like later point of time, I went into this data science stream, and that led to this whole MS and then joining Bloomberg as a engineer, when I'm ML engineer and a backend engineer as well. So yeah, I am like right now at the place where I think where I wanted back 2 years, I'm at the place now. So
and no, I mean that's a great journey. I think, you know, you've lived it, so you're just like describing it as a step one by one by one. But each step itself, like I can tell you from our students' perspective, right? You know, this is the dream for many of our students to do. And so actually, you know, before even coming to, you know, just how do you got into Bloomberg and, you know, what you studied and all of that, we'll get into that. One thing that I realized, and I think a lot of our students will also want to know, is you coming from, you know, MP to Hyderabad, then from Hyderabad to Singapore, and then Singapore to, you know, Stony Brook and then New York, you know. So those transitions, right? A lot of our students are really dreaming about those transitions. What does those transitions feel like? Right? Like, what's the difference between these cities? How did it feel like when you jumped from this one Indian city to another Indian city, and then again abroad? And then, you know, how did you feel like when you kept going on and on?
I think more than like hopping, I would say it was something back in your head which was driving these changes that you want to hop. I mean, you don't want to settle at some place, right? So that driving force is something which keeps you motivated and keeps you going forward. So I think, yeah, from like the day I started preparing from my like IIT JEE or whatever entrance exam, like since then I was quite motivated to do something in my life, which I was not aware of, obviously, at that point of time. But then, yeah, I went to Kota. So that was the first step, moving from my home, leaving my hometown and going to another city. So that was the first hop for me.
Bro, by the way, guys, sorry to interrupt, but I think going from your hometown to Kota is probably a bigger jump in terms of mindset, how it transforms your life than from going from Hyderabad to Singapore or Singapore to San Francisco. Kota stories are nuts. Mental stories I get from people.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I mean, Kota is an amazing place, man. Like, everyone should visit Kota.
No, it's not a tourist place, guys.
Half our kids here probably have been to Kota. And if you've been through Kota, I feel sorry for you. Just like for the last 10 years, I've felt sorry for Sharad also.
Yeah, I think I was just joking around regarding the Kota thing. I think, I mean, to be honest, like, it was not that bad. But yeah, down the line, when I see... Yeah. And now when I see that, it's not a, you know, that big of thing to go to Kota and crack things. You can go in your city as well, like enroll in some normal university, normal like institutes like Fidji and all. And like you can, the thing is, you have to have a willingness of like, you know, doing things.
Getting out of comfort zone, right? That's probably how I would put it. Yeah. So yeah, exactly. At Triple IT, you are a computer science and engineering graduate, is it? CSE grad. If for those of you who don't know, by the way, CSE people at Triple IT are basically royalty. Okay, these guys don't have half the course load that poor people like me did. Okay, with my dual degree masters. Okay, so they would have all the time in the world. They would sit and do this competitive programming right from second year. But yeah. Sharad has a very, very interesting journey on how he went from Triple IT to WorkSap, I think. What was your prep like, by the way? those few days?
I don't quite remember out of the prep, but yeah. But yeah, I can definitely say that it was like, it was not a one day thing, I guess. It was a culmination of months effort, I guess. And yeah, so like before like going to Singapore, joining WorkSap, I interned that company in Japan when I was in my third year.
Same company, is it?
Yeah.
So you've interned at WorkSap again in your third year, right?
Yeah, so I interned in WorkSap for the very first time in my third year. So yeah, I think that time it was pretty like hard job, I guess, because everything was new. You are giving interview for the first time. You don't know what will be like, how will you perform? Like you don't have that much of confidence, right? Like when you're giving for the first time, it's only when you have tried 2-3 times, you gain confidence and you know that what kind of questions people ask, how you have to answer it, how you have to make people understand in the interview. So yeah, it was kind of interesting.
What was the bigger cultural jump for you? Like going from Hyderabad to Singapore or Singapore to New York? Which was the bigger jump in terms of, oh my God, where have I come?
I think for me, it was from Hyderabad to Singapore, because again, like Singapore is kind of Western influenced and like it's a quite developed country as compared to India, of course. So it was a bigger jump. Like if I see relatively, like going from Singapore to US was not that big of a jump.
What's the first thing you noticed? But by the way, like, you know, wo ek hota hai na ke udhar pahunchte hi ek realization ho jata hai ke I have reached here, you know, that thing. So like, just to give an example, a lot of people say, man, I landed there and everybody is following the lanes. Everybody is following and nobody is cutting the traffic lanes. That is when I realized that I am abroad, right? Like, what is that one thing that got you that, oh, I have reached abroad? You know, what is that one thing that made you realize that?
Okay, so I think the one thing I noticed, and that was in my third year when I went to Japan. So I was standing on this traffic light signal, and the lane is totally empty from both the ends. You can't see anyone 5 kilometers ahead or behind. And there is one guy standing across the traffic signal that side. And I was with my other friends who also went to intern in that company. So we were discussing that, let's cross this because there is no one and no one is seeing. So, I mean, the traffic light stayed there for like, the signal stayed there for at least a minute or 30 seconds. I don't know what was the time. But it was quite a long. It was not that normal. Yeah. And I saw this person who is standing and who could have crossed easily because there is no one to judge or there is no one to, you know, I mean, not judge, but no one to like see.
Give a fine or something.
Yeah, like, you know, verify that he's crossing the signal on red light or whatever. And that guy is standing and waiting for a green signal. And at that very moment, I realized like, this has never happened with me in India. Neither have I followed
experience.
Yeah. People neither just have I followed in India, to be honest. At that, I mean, when I was in my third year, like, to be honest, I never followed. But yeah, now I follow. That's a different thing. But
you come back to India, I'll see how you follow these rules on Hyderabad roads.
No, and I think just in India, that's a civic sense. I hope more people get it. Agreed. It's the same thing with dustbins, by the way, as well. You know, like people, I've seen people carry trash like for 10 kilometers on end till they are able to dispose it over there. Right now you're at Bloomberg, right? Right now you're at Bloomberg. What does an ML engineer do? As much as you can tell us, I don't think you're supposed to tell us too much as well, but we all hear, and all of these guys, like, I'll tell you our students, okay? Our students are those people who heard a lot about ML, who heard a lot about deep learning and all of that. And their version of ML is, I can make a handwriting recognition software. I can make a facial recognition software. And to them, you know, ML is limited to that, right? They're not really sure they think they've heard some things. They've heard the word OpenAI. They've heard the word AlphaGo, right? They've heard these kind of things. But if, you know, because there are so many ML engineers around, I'm sure like Bloomberg has also like ton of ML engineers, and you know, all of these companies have. What does a typical ML engineer actually do in their day, right? So I think that's what a lot of people will be curious about.
So I will start by saying that, first of all, whatever notions you guys have regarding ML in general. I want to say that ML is something which I see as a tool to solve like real life problems, right? It's like any other, you can see, I mean, you use dynamic programming or you use any algorithm like graph algorithm to solve some graph problem or any other like algorithmic problem. So think ML in that way, like it's something similar on those lines, that you have algorithm or tool at your hand and you want to some real life problem. Now, the thing is, how will you solve this problem using ML? That's the question we have to tackle. I mean, we guys tackle at Bloomberg or any other company who is using ML to solve their real life problem. So, yeah. So
you're saying you look at it as a tool to solve like actual problems. So for you guys, the problems, the data, all of that comes first. And then ML is kind of like these packages like Scikit or Pandas. I'm not sure what it is that you guys use. Yeah. But that comes at the very, very end, right? Like once you've already figured out. That's a very different take, by the way. You know, and this is, guys, by the way, what you'll realize if you talk to a lot of people in the industry who are practicing ML, okay, not people who are like giving you homework assignments in your colleges or on YouTube, is that for them, ML comes so late in the pipeline. Right, to solve the entire thing, like 95% of the time would go into gathering data, gathering requirements, just understanding the problem, right? And such little time goes into actually implementing those ML models, like relatively. I think that's always fascinated me. Like for instance, students, Anik, I've always felt like they think they want to start with, so the mindset is, I will use deep learning to solve X. Right. Or I will use the TensorFlow package to do Y. And I'm like, but you're looking at it the wrong way. You're conditioning yourself in the wrong manner. Right. Your thing should be, I want to be able to better predict something. And then for that, I'll evaluate 5-10 approaches. And then I'll search for what packages will help me do it.
Right. Yeah, I think while learning. I totally agree to Abhinandan. Yeah, Anik, go ahead.
Just want to ask, like, in that vein. So you are using these, you know, tools to solve problems. What is the typical problem, if you can share, that you guys end up solving at Bloomberg, right? Or if not Bloomberg, you know, if you know any colleagues in other industries, what are the kind of problems they're using ML to solve?
So, I mean, to be honest, like for me, with ML, you can solve any problem you are solving with any algorithm, right? Like any generic algorithm you write to solve particular problem in computer science and software development, you can solve with that with ML. That's my take. And I think in general, if you talk to any ML researcher, not ML engineer, he also thinks that way, that, you know, you can build algorithm using ML. Like you can do a lot of things using ML, because at the end, it's just mathematics, the core mathematics. ML is just core mathematics. You are feeding in data, you are analyzing with some algorithm, and then you are outputting something which makes sense to you, or you make sense out of that. So I see ML as a tool, like at the end of the day. So you have to first figure out like what problem you want to solve. And second question you want to ask is whether can you solve this problem using ML, or like can you solve it with normal algorithm or normal software development technique? Because usually people fall in this prey of like, you know, ML is hot, ML is like something which everyone is doing, so why not we should do ML in everything, whatever we want to do. I think that's not a better way to go towards developing things. It should be always bottom to top approach. And I think every company do this, follow this bottom to top approach, where they go and solve some problem with normal software development techniques or normal algorithmic techniques, if they can, or not normal business logic, let's say. And then they see what is the issue they are facing when they are implementing that, or when they are like deploying those things. So only then they figure out, okay, maybe I can use ML to solve this, or to improve this process, or to improve this application in general. So that's where the ML thinking comes in. It's not always that you want to, you know, start with ML. I don't think so. Around the world, any application developer thinks that way, that, you know, you want to first build ML application and then do something else. Yeah, I'm not talking about any ML company. Like, any company who is just focused on AI or things like that. Bloomberg is not AI company, right? It's a fintech company. So they have a lot of problems on hand where they want automation or they want smart intelligence out of the system, which humans cannot do or which humans will take a lot of time. So that's where we can leverage the ML techniques.
So for instance, Anik, I was just having this discussion with another common friend of ours. We'd lovely to get him on the on one of the Edis Pro Talk series as well. So this is a guy who works at Walmart. I mean, I won't reveal his name or anything right now, but I was just having a conversation with him as to what these guys work on. Walmart, if you guys know, is like Flipkart and Amazon of the US. They're trying to come into India, right? So he's also a data, I mean, I don't know if he's a data scientist, but I think he works with a team of data scientists, ML engineers. The problem they were solving at Walmart is very interesting. They were like, so if people select three or four items together, and this is Walmart is basically your, you know, those self-service checkouts where you have to go and, you know, like it's a, so basically they have counters at Walmarts wherein if you say, I want eggs and I want bread, then they wanted to be able to recommend, hey, why don't you also purchase this and this, and overall your cost will go down. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the kind of things that they were trying to do with ML. Okay. And it's a very layered problem. Like you have to, you know, understand that, oh, these food items go together. So they'll have to, you know, take data of all previous purchases. You know, what do people, you know, frequently combine together? Then you have to do this. I think that, I don't know if the price optimization bit is solved using machine learning. I don't think so. They keep, that's something that he was working on. Right.
I think it's like what because this is the kind of a problem. This is what the cashier would have anyways recommended anyways. Like Sharad was saying, right? Like you have an existing problem, you have an existing algo, or you have an existing business process, and you know, how can you automate that or, you know, make that more seamless? And that is when you attack it with ML, right? And then you say that, hey, can ML intervene and, you know, really help you out, right? So I guess that's what it's going for. Yeah.
Sharad, there, Bloomberg. Okay, mm-hmm. It's a finance company, right?
Yeah, it's a fintech company.
It's a fintech company. So what, they deal with stocks and stuff? Matlab trading?
Yeah, so you can do a lot of things using Bloomberg Terminal. I'm not an expert in Bloomberg Terminal since I am a very tiny part of Bloomberg, a very, very tiny part of Bloomberg. But yeah, Bloomberg Terminal, you can think it as a universe of applications, I guess. Because on Bloomberg Terminal, you have a lot of applications to analyze the data in very different way, which like, you know, any financial
data.
You can basically see any financial data. You can see any financial analytics on Bloomberg.
It's like, I think it's like the bash of fintech, right? Is what I've heard.
It's like, command line.
That's what I've heard. It's like command line shell for any fintech stuff. Like if you're a serious trader, and when I say serious trader, please, there are a lot of people in the audience will be like, sir, I trade stocks.
Chindi stocks nahi chahiye.
So if you're really day trading, you know, at those milliseconds trading, if you're not on Bloomberg Terminal, it's like saying that, you know, I want to travel the world using a cycle. I mean, you can do it for a hobby, but it's not going to happen. You know, you're not going to compete with the big guys. So one of our users had a very interesting question saying that, you know, like today in your graduation, in your undergraduation, you get like a lot of chance. You can either, you know, take up tutorials on data science, you can take up tutorials on full stack. Like when did you, Sharad, when did you realize, like at what stage of your academics did you start working in ML? Like when did you realize that, you know, you wanted to be in the field of ML, and what stage in your academics did you start working on it?
So like in academics, I was introduced, I believe in third year, I don't remember exactly, but I think it was sixth semester, third year of my undergrad, where I was introduced to ML as a course, not something which I was aware of. And like, it ended up fascinating me all along till now. So yeah, like I got introduced in my undergrad. And then, I mean, when I went to Singapore, I was not doing much of ML. Like I was not doing anything related to ML. I was a data engineer, backend engineer. But yeah, like I was seeing that there is a lot of, I mean, something which I am missing from my work is that how can I smartly build applications? Like, I mean, not smartly build applications, how can I put smartness in the application, or how can I put intelligence in the application that can help solve our client problems, or that can solve very real world problems like related to the application. So that is something which was missing back when I was like working in Singapore. So I was not doing anything ML there. So I think I was motivated for ML from my undergrad, and that led me to do my master's.
Your serious study, serious study was at master's level, right? When you went for your data science master's.
Right.
Stony Brook. Nice.
Correct.
I think that must have been like a very rigorous curriculum, right? 1.5 years full of math, full of statistics.
It was. I mean, I should say it was not that rigorous, but yeah, I got introduced to a lot of concepts which I was not aware of. And like, I was solving some real world problems at hand, dealing with the real data sets, trying to analyze and trying to figure out how we can, like, you know, solve this problem given this data set. How will you come up with the feature set? How will you come up with the, what models will you choose to solve this problem? So all that, like, you know, trying to figure out thing. And like, when you say that trying to figure out thing, you go back at your comfort zone and then you try to see like what else you can do. Like, you, I mean, obviously there are libraries, there are a lot of things you can try on, but exactly what you want to do is like, when you sit back and think, okay, let me lay down the problem. Let me figure out like how people have solved this problem before. And let me figure out if there is a good way I can get insight from that. So all this thing, I mean, all this to and fro learning process makes you able to do whatever you want to do in any field, right? It's not something related to ML. But yeah, coming back to your question, I was introduced to ML in my undergrad and then I seriously pursued that in my master's, and then I am pursuing that in my job here, hopefully seriously.
And so one thing, like just as a continuation of that, how was your journey of joining Bloomberg? Like, you obviously did your master's in the US, but then how did you end up, like, you know, joining Bloomberg from that? Like, I think a lot of people are always curious about, is there like campus hiring that happens in US? Like, do they also have placement rounds as, you know, we have in India? Or, you know, do you have to go in a different way? So, you know, just curious about that.
A very good question. So I think for, in my case, like I applied for campus hiring thing, but I got rejected. I was not selected. I don't know why. Maybe I was not that capable of at that time. So I applied online. And usually what happens is that in online, you have to very, like, you have to outstand in a lot of people, right? That's when they select you to at least call for the first round of interview. So I was not like that hopeful that I will get a call when I applied online, but eventually I got a call when I applied online. So yeah, like people do get hired from the campus as well. People do get hired from the online as well. I got hired from the online portal thing. And like the regarding the journey of the interview process, it was very standard process, multiple rounds of interviews, drilling down your data structures knowledge, drilling down your systems knowledge, system design knowledge, and drilling down your basic computer science concepts, not related to data structures, but basic computer science concept related to your programming languages. So here is something which plays the role, coming back to your question where you said that, okay, I can apply some library and I build this application, so I can do whatever now. But when it comes to things like these, like the interview process and all, you should be knowing your application, or you should be knowing the concept really well if you want to really excel in your life further.
Superb. And it's very inspiring as well, because a lot of students, I don't know why, but you know, they have this feeling in their head that, you know, it's either on campus or I don't even, you know, think that I'm going to get a particular job at all, you know. And then off campus is a completely different thing. But so many of the people we talk to, they are sitting in the best of companies like Bloomberg, like Facebook, Google, and so many of them have actually got into the companies from an off campus, from an online portal, probably from a referral, right? So just a message to all our students also out there, right? Don't think that on campus is everything. Even if you're not from a great campus, it does not mean you can't get into it. Or if you missed your on-campus round, you can still get into a great company. So don't think that you're constrained or you're, you know, stopped by it. All right, so that's really all of the serious questions. I have a couple of fun questions, but before I get to the fun questions, Abhinandan, do you want to chime in there, anything from your end about this?
Yeah, so yeah, first of all, like one of the things that you guys, like with when you talk to people who've kind of made it, right? As in, there's not a lot of better companies than Bloomberg in the world to work at. It's, I mean, I think in the fintech services, I don't know if there's a bigger company than Bloomberg, by the way. And Sharad is like right in the epicenter, right in the New York office. That's where he's at. His master's was from, again, one of America's finest universities. But one thing that I always, you know, that it always comes as such a nice surprise to me is just how humble a lot of our friends have stayed. Right. Like, I don't know, you know, I mean, a lot of people like, I mean, I'm pretty sure Sharad takes it for granted that, you know, hey, this is just how I am. You know, I don't know if that's a big deal or whatever, but it's very humbling to notice that, by the way, even as a friend, you know, that is something that fills me with pride, knowing that these guys, like, for instance, Sharad, I know, is one of the most hardworking people that I knew back in college. Okay. I don't care if he wasn't winning any international Olympiads, but this guy's work ethic was spot on. Okay, like he's one of the most reliable people you know, right? If you were in a group project with this guy, okay, and you wanted to get something done, you know that Sharad is not someone you have to worry about. Okay, he aega, he apna kaam karega, he'll make sure that you don't have to worry about him, right? And he takes that work ethic. This guy, you know, from Hyderabad, he goes to Singapore, sick, does his master's. I don't even know the kind of projects he's made, man. Now he's sitting in one of the world's biggest companies. And I really, really like the fact that he's still humble. He's still down to earth. Yeah, Rani, when this happens is when I think tumhare life ke priorities are sorted. You know, I think Sharad, for instance, for people who have spoken to him, thoda sa, typically, like people like Sharad, when you speak to them, right? Unka problem ko dekhne ka nazariya bahut alag hai yaar. Like the way that they look at their careers, the way that they look at progress. Wo jo hota na, am I successful? Kya hai? Hum chindi log, matlab generally kya hai India mein? Arre itta salary mil gaya, utta paisa mil gaya. I don't even think that's the primary consideration for people like Sharad. They genuinely love the subject. Isko data science se genuinely pyar hai. You can see that in the way that he talks about it, right? And I think that contributes to, you know, keeping you humble, keeping you focused, keeping you grounded. और फिर पहुंचते हो ना यार तुम हैदराबाद से न्यूयॉर्क और फिर कान क्या लगाया तूने ये व्हाट स्वैग आर यू रॉकिंग टुडे
फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वांट टू थैंक अभिनंदन फॉर हिज काइंड वर्ड्स
प्लीज
नो बट द लेसन हियर इज आई थिंक व्हाट अभिनंदन इज ट्राइंग टू टेल ऑल आवर स्टूडेंट्स इज यू डोंट गेट एनीवेयर विदाउट हार्ड वर्क एंड आई थिंक एवरीबॉडी हियर्स दिस एवरी अदर मोटिवेशन स्टोरी टेल्स यू दिस दैट यू नीड हार्ड वर्क टू बी वेयरएवर यू आर एंड सो ऑन बट जस्ट सीइंग कांस्टेंट रिमाइंडर्स ऑफ दैट इज गुड Right, and the biggest issue right now in with freshers is this get rich quick schemes. You know, 2 minutes do this course, you will be done. 5 minutes take this tutorials, and you will be done. And you know, it takes the kind of work that you know Sharad is showing you in the sense of preparation that he did, the rejections that he's faced, the maths he's learned, the algorithms he's learned, the projects he's done. You need that kind of a prep to be somewhere. And that's not to say it's inaccessible. It's not it's impossible to be there. It's just that you have to be up for the journey. Right, so that's what I think Abhi is also trying to say here. And also, you're wearing some really good earphones. I think that's also he's trying to say.
Yeah, I'm wearing some PowerBeats Pro.
PowerBeats Pro, yeah. So guys, yeah. That's what your aim should be in life. That one day I can also wear PowerBeats Pro headphones.
No, okay. That should not be your aim. Definitely, that should not be your aim.
That's a great side effect.
I can say that, but that should never be your aim.
Right.
Fun so, questions, Lavya Ranik. Where are the fun questions?
So, as you might have seen, a very popular TV show, they introduced this round called the Rapid Fire Round, right? So we will have a very quick Rapid Fire Round with Sharad. Okay. As you all know the rules, I'm not putting a timer or anything, but just try to answer as quickly as possible. Okay. And we'll start with a very simple question and then, you know, we'll keep putting it up. So I have like about 5-6 questions for the Rapid Fire. So anyways, are you ready, Sharad?
Sure.
Okay, let's start. So Sharad, what's your favorite programming language?
Python.
Okay. What's your favorite song that you're listening to right now?
It's by Glass Animals. It's called Heat Waves.
Heat Waves by Glass Animals. Nice. Okay.
Yeah.
You've been to many cities. Which is your favorite city so far? Or
Tokyo?
Town? Okay, Tokyo. Very nice.
Yeah.
Okay. Favorite place in India?
Delhi.
Okay, very nice. All right. What's your favorite snack?
Snack, Bhelpuri.
Bhelpuri. See, you guys can take, yeah. Take anybody to New York, but he will not do the Bhelpuri. Nice. I love it. Okay. Are you someone who likes mountains or are you someone like who likes beaches?
Mountains.
Okay. All right. Let's say you are like stranded on an island, okay, and you had only 3 books to take with you. Okay. I'm assuming you read. If you don't read, I can change the question. But
I don't read that often.
Okay, cool. So I'll change the question. Let's say you're going to an island and you have a TV and you have three movies to take with you. Okay. Which three movies would you take to an island?
So one movie is called The Beautiful Mind. It's a movie on the life of John Nash. And then I think another is related to the Ramanujan one. It's the man who knew infinity, I guess. And then other would be, I don't know, some Indian movie.
Might take a rom-com. Take a masala Bollywood flick. Okay, rom-com. All this high intellectual
stuff.
There
is no rom-com in my life right now. So no rom-com.
Okay, which Bollywood movie would you take? The third one.
Three Idiots, anytime.
Okay, brilliant. All right. So one quote that has inspired you, one quote or saying that has really inspired you.
So it's by Linus Torvalds. Being a computer science student, I think everyone knows it. Talk is cheap, show me the code.
nice. Okay. And the last question for you is, there are a lot of freshers watching this video. Okay. They are from all walks of life. There is somebody watching from, let's say, Delhi and Bombay, from the best universities. There is somebody from the most rural engineering college who's never been out of their district. Okay.
Right.
If you had to, you know, even just suggest, like, what is one advice that you would, you know, suggest for all freshers? You know, just one advice that you think is applicable to all freshers out there.
I think the most important advice is don't hesitate in trying things, new things. You should always try out whatever is out there. Be an opportunist, I guess. That's something which I think that I missed in my life when I was in undergrad. So I definitely want to say to everyone that be an opportunist, at least when you are a fresher. Like, try to grab any opportunity you are getting, trying to like be on a project or being in any curriculum activity or anything, like, for that matter. So yeah, try to be someone who wants to do things. That's it.
Awesome. So yeah, that's it for this version of Pro Talks. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Once again, if you want to ask any questions to the guests, do let us know in the comments below. We'll make sure that, you know, when we interact with them next time, we get the answers for it. And if you want to be involved in the next Pro Talk session and you want your questions, etc., to be answered, follow us on Edist.me. That's our Instagram channel. And you will get all of the updates on who's coming up next and what are the guests that are coming up. Thanks so much, Sharad, for joining us today. And thank you, Abhinandan, also.
Thanks a lot, Anik and Abhinandan, for calling me on this stage. And yeah, guys, do follow this company. They are doing great job and they will be doing great in upcoming years. I'm pretty sure about that. So yeah,
thanks, Yasha. Thanks for kind
words. I vote for both of you, and yeah, best of luck. Thanks a lot.
Thanks so much. So guys, if you enjoyed this podcast, don't forget to hit the like button, share it with your friends, and for to receive further notifications, please do subscribe. Thanks, everybody.
WhatsApp, Telegram, yeah. Whatever you get, spam it there, man.
Yeah, share it
everybody. Everybody.
Chalo. All right. Thanks, everybody, for joining in. And we'll catch you all next time. Bye, guys. Bye, Sharad. Bye.
Bye.